Hey, we're live. Just wait for a few more people to come on. Another day, another dollar. Welcome. And just make sure we've got decent audio. So if you're watching, give me a thumbs up. Tell me that the audio is good, that we've got good audio. So what I need to find out. Welcome. DJ Norman. How are you doing? Welcome to let live stream. Let me just put it like that so you haven't got the glare of the light. That is a bit better. Audio good. Thank you, sir. What can I say except welcome to live stream here. We're going to talk about constructing your mobile DJ set and, in my eyes, potentially what could be the best set you'll ever do. Now, all right, admittedly, there aren't many people of us or aren't many actually working at the moment, but doesn't matter. It's all about preparation. And now we have time to prepare. So we get straight into it. Tracks. What to play. Now, gigs, there's many gigs. You've got your weddings. You've got your bar mitzvahs. You've got your anniversaries. You've got your birthday parties. You've got your garden parties. You've got your cocktail parties. You've got your dance events. There are all manner of gigs. But the fundamentals stay the same. We are the entertainers, and we're there to create an atmosphere. And that's the key. So you could be the best DJ in the world, and you could have the best music in the world. But if you can't create the atmosphere using the tools that you have, which is, of course, the kit and the music, then forget it. So what I'm trying to say here, excuse me, even if, for example, it's a little bit like, let me give you an analogy. It's a little bit like having 10 artists and giving each actual artist, a painter, you know, people who paint, that sort of artist, because I know artist is general, but giving each of them the same paintbrushes, the same canvas, and the same paints, and asking them to paint a picture of a bowl of fruit that's in front of them. So they can all paint the bowl of fruit, but not all of them will produce a great picture that will just rock the crowd, even though they've got the same items to use. And this is exactly the same with DJs, because you could have two DJs who have exactly the same tracks to use. In other words, you imagine you've got two rooms with a mixture of age groups and people who like different music, and they've both got exactly the same tracks to use. So if you put it like that, it's even, isn't it, really? You know, no one's going to be have any advantage over the other DJ. But it's about the tracks and how they use those tracks. That's the key. That's the important part. So hopefully with this live stream, I'll be able to help you determining what to play, how to play it, and so on. I need to go to the video here. And if I go back, because I need to find out if we had, we had two comments on the video I made. Just see, I'll try to make it. Always struggle with modern tracks for young people. This is Stuart Harrison. Okay. So I'm going to go over a couple of the question, or well, the one question I had, which is really about the stream anyway. So let's have a think about an event. Now, first of all, it doesn't really matter what event it is. It doesn't matter. You're there to create the atmosphere. Now, the music, of course, will make the atmosphere, but you're in control of the music. So it's very similar to, again, another analogy, same as the artist, a chef in a kitchen with a multitude of ingredients. You've got the best ingredients in the world. You've got smoked salmon, you've got caviar, you know, you've got lobster, you've got venison, you've got the best vegetables and fruit. But if you don't know how to put those together to make great meals, you might as well be in a small greasy spoon somewhere with sausage and baked beans. Because if you don't know what to do with the products you've got, then you're just there. You're not doing anything. And it's exactly the same as a DJ. You could have 100 tracks that are great songs to use, or you could have 10,000 tracks that are all great songs to use. But if you don't know how to put them together, then you're lost. So this video is about how to put those tracks together and what to do, what to look out for. Now, the first thing I do when I get to an event, get to any gig, is apart from make a recce of the room and work out where to place things, and this will be in a future live stream, setup, because setup is vital. I don't want to go into that now because it's a completely different subject. But once I've set up my gear, and even while I'm setting up my gear, I will make note of the people in the room. Age, what they're dressed, how they're dressed, how they talk, how they act, if they're smiling, if they're happy, if they're drunk, if they're sober, if they're annoyed, if they're angry, if they're anything. I'll try and get a feel of how the people are in that room. And this is really important because this determines on very possibly how you will start your night. Because you see, excuse me, runny nose. You see, if the people are like stiff upper lip and got a pole shoved at the backside, and you know, you feel as though they're not going to enjoy themselves, then you don't want to come across then as this bouncy, bubbly DJ, and full on, because they'll look at you as though you're an idiot. You know, it's a little bit like trying to cut a cake with a chainsaw. You know, you're wasting your time. You need to slowly build up, you know, introduce yourself, get used to the crowd. On the other hand, you know, if you walk into the venue and they have been there since, and you start the evening at 6 o'clock, they've been there since midday and they're all hammered, the last thing you want to do is start playing background music and just chilling out and relaxing, because they'll be good to go. They'll be ready to go. Now, there's a lot of different ways we can start the evening. But again, the first thing to remember, and again, write this down or watch this video again, is make note of the crowd themselves and how they are as a whole, as a crowd. You've always got in, let's say for a wedding party, you've always got a few that are happy, jolly, good to go. You've got your mumsies and dadsies, you've got your boys and girls, you know, a mixture of age groups. But with a wedding is very different to a birthday party. So let's imagine you've got a wedding party and you've got an 18th birthday party. Not only that, but let's just imagine, to make it sort of slightly more even, that the wedding of the two people are 18. They're both 18. So you've got a husband and wife who are now married, who are both 18. And you've got a boy or a girl who are having their birthday, who are 18. Now, if you look at it like that, you're going to have, theoretically, a similar age group of people, because you're going to have probably the mums and dads who are going to turn up at the 18th birthday party and eventually get kicked out. You're going to have all their friends who are of the same age. It's obvious. And exactly the same with a wedding. But the fundamental difference between those two groups of people is very big. It's vast. It's immense. And a lot of you maybe haven't thought about this. But let's first of all look at the 18th birthday party. Now, these people have probably got up normal time in the morning. They've got about their daily business, or they've had a lie-in. They've gone to work. They've just been milling around doing daily things. And then maybe about 4 or 5 o'clock, they've decided to start getting ready to go out to the party. So they're fresh. They're ready to go. On the other hand, a wedding, the bride has possibly been up since 5 o'clock having her hair done. The groom has probably got up at 11 o'clock in the morning with a considerably bad hangover. You've got the bride's mother and father, the groom's mother and father, who've been milling around early hours of the morning. And then they've got all the procedure of going to the church and the car and the flowers and the organizing. So not only have they been up a long time, they're a little bit stressed. So when you're DJing at a wedding party, these people are a little bit more tense and tired, let's say, as opposed to the 18th birthday party. So, and that makes a big difference. That makes a great big difference. Because I don't know if you've noticed, if you've done 18th birthday parties, but if the bar closes at 1 and they've got to be kicked out, they're always asking for one more. And there's always loads left. Whereas with a wedding, quite often, a lot of people will leave early because they're not really used to partying all night. They very rarely get asked out. They've probably never been to a nightclub in the past 20 years. And they're tired. So after they've had their meal, watched the first dance and, you know, jigged around to Madonna or Michael Jackson or ABBA, they go home. So, you know, that is the big difference between an 18th birthday party and a wedding, that the wedding party have been up and busy all day. So they're tired. Okay, let's just have a look here. I love the happy hardcore. Have that at my wedding. Swanky 2006. Yeah, well, why not? It doesn't matter. Okay, so. Right. So back to basics here. You've turned up. You're looking at the crowd and you're getting an idea of the energy in that room. This is really important because you've got to remember, music is energy. It gives a vibration. It makes you happy, sad, indifferent, or it just makes you want to throw something through a window and walk away and kill yourself because you never want to hear that track again because it's crap. On the other hand, for someone else, that could be a brilliant track, whereas what you like, they hate. We're all different. But if you can get an idea of how the people feel in that room, then that will give you an idea of how to start the evening. So as I said earlier, if you know they're laid back and they're sat there and they've got poles up the backside and they look as though, you know, they've got lemons in the mouths, you don't want to come straight in like this party animal because they're just going to think you're idiots. You're an idiot. You need to slowly introduce them into starting to enjoy themselves. So by doing that, maybe you want to start off with some classic soul, or maybe some Motown, some Northern soul, something like that, just to get them going. But again, a lot of it is about the age group as well, because that's important. If they're all quite young, then that's probably not going to work. If they're all sort of 50s and 60s and 70s, then that will work. You see, again, say, for example, the likes of, you know, waltzes or foxtrots. Now, a lot of DJs would never, ever consider playing a waltz or a foxtrot. But then if you look at the crowd and you've got to remember you've got grandparents there as well, that possibly was just about still their era, you know, the 60s, early 70s, 50s. So they might like something like that. And in fact, as well, and I've learned many a lesson, if you please them to begin with, they're going to be very happy. Whereas if you don't bother with them, by the time you start to play the music that they would have liked to have listened to, they've gone home because they're knackered. And then they'll probably think, oh, it was a crap DJ because they never played anything that we danced to. And you see, that's a lot of the psyche of people, because they're in their own little universe. And even though you could have a room with, say, 100 people in, if one person doesn't dance because they don't like any of your music, in their eyes, you were crap because you didn't play anything for them. You see, it is very difficult. There's a lot of psychology here. So let me just have a look at some of these messages here. Happy hardcore at a wedding. That'd be wedding I'd actually like to go to. Yeah. Vids VR. Yeah, Jonathan, but sometimes. Babe Blink 61. You get a crowd that is way different what you thought or expected, referring to different genres. Yeah. I can cover that in a bit. I'm the guy who learned all I know from your videos, and you've already have great explanations. Bogdan, Roadie, thank you. DJ Normal Norman, Phil Collins in the air tonight, first track. Yeah, great song. It's like an icebreaker, you know. It's Christopher, Lady in Red, something like that. They're just very good songs. I mean, like Christopher, Lady in Red. It's actually a very, very good song to play to begin with, because it's danceable. It's actually quite soulful and a classical moody track. But at the same time, it's got a nice upbeat tempo that people can dance to. So this is a good way of introducing people onto the dance floor if you can see that the mood isn't party atmosphere full on and right. So let's imagine we've got that sort of crowd that are very laid back, chilled out, and aren't ready to be full on party. Then by all means, start with, you know, your classical tracks. Tina Turner, for example, George Michael, Careless Whisper. You see, back in the day, in the 80s and 90s, very often at wedding gigs, I'd always finish with a slow smoochy song. And it was like the in thing. But that seems to have disappeared now, where people don't want to finish with a smoochy. They want to finish full on with some full on euphoric track. And I get that, because, you know, you want to walk out the room happy, not sort of walk out the room like chilled out. But being the DJ and being the person who is the entertainer and also in control of the atmosphere in said room, if you feel like there is hell of a lot of energy in that room, to the extent that there's going to be friction or there's going to be fighting or there's going to be a lot of rowdy people outside, you know, singing your last song that you would like them to do, but then do you really want them to start screaming and shouting outside? And then members of the public who live down the road say, oh, that DJ, you know, when, or not so much him or her, but when the gig finished, everyone was walking out screaming and shouting. It's going to give the venue a bad name. So, you know, you're in this awkward position of thinking, well, I really do want to let them finish on a high note, but at the same time, I need to reduce the energy so they walk away a little bit more chilled out, but still having a good night. And there are great tracks to do that. For example, like Bob Marley, you know, some Bob Marley tunes, Two Little Birds, One Love, you know, Frank Sinatra, New York, New York. Great tracks that have still got loads of energy, but do bring the vibe down. So you're calming the people down a little bit. You go from start and it's great. Bablink 61. Some people get so mad when you do not play their song. They think that you dislike that. I know. Yeah. But again, playing people's tracks, you can't just stop everything and play their song, because it might not fit in with the tracks you're playing. And it could just could kill the atmosphere. So what I want to talk about now is, you know, how we can go through a set and what we can play. Now, if we, let's say, thought about the structure of your set, one of the worst things in the world to do by far is to play a 60s track and then play a 90s dance track and then play a popular song from the top 40 now and then play a 70s track and then play a reggae track and then play a hip hop track and then play a soul track. So, all right, hip hop, soul, similar kind of, you know, it depends about BPM. But what you're doing is you're, okay, so I'm going to contradict myself here. You can do that, but you've got to be very, very clever at selecting the tracks so they harmonically work together and that the energy and the feel of those tracks work together. But that's very difficult to do. And if you can't do that, don't try. Because what you're doing is you're giving the listener, the people listening, an old school tune. And then all of a sudden, you're going into a popular song. And then you're going into a rock song. And then you're going into a disco song. You know, you're jumping around all the genres. And people won't know where they're going. Because, you see, a lot of people will like rock. And if you play a rock song, for example, you know, heavy metal song, AC/DC, Nirvana, something like that, REM, you know, that sort of style, more guitar orientated, you just play one of those and then you go into a dance track. Okay, people are going to enjoy that song, but you will have a selection of the crowd who like that style and would expect more of that. So it's always a good idea if you're going to start on a certain genre or style to stick to it for a while. So let's get back to what I said earlier. You've got the crowd who are a bit moody. You've brought them up with, you know, some mellow Michael Jackson, some, you know, nice melodic ABBA tracks, Gloria Gaynor. You know, you slowly lifted them up, Lionel Richie, and now, you know, you're into maybe disco. So now you can go into Chic, you know, Brothers Johnson, you know, good classic disco tracks. Now, the disco era, if you're not familiar with it, it epitomizes dance music of today, because a lot of the disco tracks, the dance tracks of today are here because of the samples of the disco tracks. So even though some of the public, you know, the younger generation may not have heard of the disco tracks you're playing, they will know of them because some of the sounds and vocals and melodies of the old school disco tracks are in modern day tracks. So they'll be able to dance to them and enjoy them because they can see in a way that they know what the track is, even though they've probably never heard of it before. They just know the modern day version. So you've gone into sort of some disco stuff, and then by this time, maybe you've brought the crowd up a little bit. Now, what I always recommend to everyone, and this is what I will always do, is that at the beginning of every single night, I'll make sure the tracks I play, 100% the crowd will know. I won't start playing any tracks that I like, but I'm not sure if the crowd like or know about. I will always play the tracks that the crowd No. In other words, tracks that have definitely been in the top 40, not only been in the top 40, but been high up in the top 40. So it's more than likely that they have been played a lot on the radio. Therefore, it's more likely that everyone knows them. Now, again, general top 40, anything in the top 10 is going to be played a lot more than anything from 30 to 40. You just have to look at pure logic. So the higher up it is in the charts, the more likely it's going to be played more on the radio, which means the more likely people will have heard it because, you know, Radio 1 play the same tracks every bloody hour anyway. So this is what I want to get hold of, is play the tracks people know. Now, as we move on, there's more and more tracks coming out. And, you know, I mean, there is so much choice. You know, there is so much choice. I can see the chat going here, so have a look through here. Let's have a look. Some people get so mad when, yeah, okay, I actually punched a bloke who kept asking for drum and bass that was in a club. DJ normal. Well, it's not very good to hit someone, but I have had an altercation, which I'll tell you about very shortly, way back in the day in Norway. Bublink 51, freestyle versus prepared sets. I find it hard while freestyling to keep the energy up. So I do both, mate, if I can be really tough with the crowds. Yeah, fair enough, Paul C. That's true. The likes of Dr. Packer plus a modern spine on disco. Yeah. Okay. So, and that's from Paul C. It's me, DJ Mario. Yo, yo. How are you doing, guys? All right. So again, you know, I've gone from my sort of disco selection, and then maybe I'll go into maybe some party music, you know. And again, you know, the term party music, how can I put it? It's a song that has that party vibe, atmosphere, Wigfield, Saturday night, the Macarena, you know, the cha-cha slide, those sorts of tracks. Now, let's say, for example, the Macarena. If I was, say, in the kitchen, chilling out, relaxing, and all of a sudden someone came in and put the Macarena on in the kitchen, I'd give them a slap across the face with a wet piece of cod. I would. I'd say, how dare you play that shit? You know, I don't want to listen to that crap. On the other hand, when I'm at a venue playing and I know it's the right time, right place, and I put the Macarena on, I'm vibing, I'm enjoying it, I'm loving it, because I am part of the energy in that room. And there's nothing better than seeing a whole bunch of people enjoying themselves, and I'm loving it. I personally am absolutely loving it. But that doesn't mean to say I love the track. It's just because of the time where I'm playing it and the energy and the vibe it's giving the people, and the people are giving me and themselves. So you go into maybe a party set. Now, after a party set, you know, you could consider then going into, say, some rock stuff. You know, like I said, your REM and your AC/DC and so on. Alice Cooper, for a start. You know, the old school rock tracks. There's loads of them. And then from there, there's nothing better than the likes of 60s tracks. Now, if I played like Little Richard Tutti Frutti or Bill Haley Rock Around the Clock, I would hazard a guess to say there's probably not one person in the room who hasn't heard of those songs, whatever age. All right, you know, 4 and 5 year olds, they've yet to maybe hear it where their mums, dads, and grandparents have got to play it. But I would have thought all age groups would have heard that by now, those songs. They're classic tracks, and they're great for generating the energy in the room. Now, the key there is what I just said, energy in the room, because the way you put your set together is creating the energy in the room. All right, now I'll say it again. The way you put your set together is creating the energy in the room. Now that is fundamental. That is really important, because how you put your set together will indeed create the energy in the room. So what do I mean by that? How can I expand on that? Well, say you've got 10 tracks. And if you play track 2 after track 1, track 3 after track 2, track 4 after track 3, and so on up to 10, you may not get or generate any energy in that room. But on the other hand, if you say play track 2 first, then 7 after 2, then 3 after 7, then 9 after 3, then 1 after 9, and then 10 after 1, and so on, you could have that room buzzing, going bonkers. Why? It's about how the tracks fit next to each other, how the keys work. Now, music is a vibration. Music is energy. And a track that you play has a certain energy. And the energy, a lot of it, is based on the key of the track. So if you play a track with a certain key and you bring another one in with a certain key and those two keys harmonically work, then you will be able to transfer the energy from one to the other based on also on how the tracks gel with each other. So, for example, you could have a hip hop tune of the same key as, say, a 60s track. It could be the same key. But if you go from hip hop to 60s with the same key, then from 60s to techno with the same key, then from techno to drum and bass with the same key, that set's going to be all over the place. But the energy and the vibe will seem to be the same because they're harmonically matched. Whereas if you go from a 60s track to another 60s track, to maybe Tamla Motown, then to maybe Northern Soul, in the same key or keys that harmonically work, you will keep the energy at a constant. Because if you think about it and try this, have you ever been into a room or played a track, brought the next one in, only to find people have left the dance floor? Even if you beat matched it in time, in phrase, or you just chopped it in time, all of a sudden the people leave the dance floor. It's very possible because they're not harmonically matched. And the keys of music is the key. This is like the holy grail of DJing. It's not about getting them in beat. It's not about getting them in phrase. It's about making sure that they're harmonically matched. And if you can harmonically match the tracks you're playing, you're halfway there. Okay? So I hope that does make sense, because that is vitally important. Blaze Lewis, it's so weird watching someone on live from the house that you're in. Bless him. That's my son. How are you watching? Were you on your laptop, Blaze? You monkey. Depending on the type of event, it's also important to read the crowd, as in age, musical tastes. Yeah, that's it. Virgil Williams, whatever happened to Lisa Stansfield? Because after she won the Grammy for People to Hold On, she just ghosted on everyone. Well, a lot of artists do that. And again, that in itself is a discussion. But the music industry, I'll be honest with you, it's like a machine. It's a factory, okay? A factory that makes baked beans, churns out baked beans. And if you think about it, that factory doesn't like make 1,000 baked bean tins and then think, oh, let's keep 10 of them because, you know, they mean so much to us and we'll keep them and we'll store them safe in a cupboard and look back at them in 10 years' time and think, oh, we made these 10 years ago. We need to keep them. No, it just churns them out. Doesn't give a shit. It's exactly the same with the music industry. All right. You know, artists, new artists, make loads of money. Radio, TV, personality, celebrity. Great. You're too old. Piss off, the next one comes in. That's how it is, all right? It's never going to change, and no one can tell me it's any different. You know, this is why recently, over the past decade, some very, very big artists have magically disappeared off the face of the earth, because they were so big, they were taking too much money, and they were taking too much limelight, and they had to be got rid of to make space for the next generation of artists, who in turn, after 6 months or a couple of years, could just move away for the next lot. And that's how it is, all right? It's never going to change. So yeah, so back to very controversial there, by the way. Okay, do you ever ask the person who's okay? So, all right, whatever happens, so at least it stands for okay. So make your sets in key, period. Yes, and that's to Bablink 61. So make your sets in key, but also make sure when you make your sets in key that you are keeping structurally to sets of styles. So don't just play one house, one hip hop, then one techno, then one trance, then one old school, then one disco. Make sure you've got a collection of style, a collection of one style together. So you play like four or five disco tracks and then five or six popular, you know, top 40 tracks, then five or six dance tracks, and then five or six soul tracks, you know? So what you're doing then is the people who like disco, they're not just listening to one song and thinking, oh, is that it? Is that all you're giving us? And now you're playing bloody rock and roll. Come on, we want more. Whereas if you play five or six disco tracks, they're like, wait, thank you, brilliant. You know, you've got your cool in the gang. You know, you're playing chic. You're playing maybe, all right, disco, Madonna-ish, you know. And then you've satisfied them. And then you've got a bunch of people who want Northern Soul, Tamla Motown. Play a bunch, you know. I mean, you try, or I'm sure people will agree with me here. You know, if you play one Northern Soul or one Tamla Motown track, and that's it, they'll think you're an idiot. They'll be like, why only the one? Hold on. You know, why just one? We want more. And then I guarantee you, try it next time you're out there. Play just one Tamla Motown and then go to another genre, and you're going to get people coming up to you saying, is that it? Just one? They'll want more. Try it. Just test it. Do you ever ask the person whose party you're playing at or what kind of music they want, or do you just go with the flow? Now, again, that does depend on the party, but what I will do definitely with a wedding, and this is prior to the event, the playlist from the bride and groom and so on, I'll always ask the bride and the groom, what do you like, what don't you like? And actually, the what don't you like is important, because if the bride says, I don't want you to play Madonna, you don't play it. Even if a member of the public says, can you put Madonna on? It's my daughter's favorite track. You don't say no. What you say is, you know, you don't put the onus on yourself. You put the onus out there. And you say, I do apologize, but the bride has specifically said that she doesn't want me to play Madonna. So I do apologize. It's not me. It's the bride. 99% of the time, the people are like, yeah, that's fine, you know, because they've just been invited to the party. On the odd occasion, you'll get some idiot who'll go, oh, God, bloody silly cow, you know, but that very rarely happens. So, you know, again, it's a good idea to get an idea. A good idea to get an idea of what the people in charge of the party do like. Because also, generally, if they like house music, then a lot of their friends are going to like house music. And if they do, we're quids in, aren't we? So I hope that helps there. Get them to make a Spotify playlist. Oh, I hate Spotify. Bablink 61, I play all different types of genres, so it's tough to keep all in key. I do play five or six. It's not tough at all to play in key. It's not. It's absolutely not. Just because you're playing house and you're going to hip hop, you haven't all of a sudden got to think, oh, I can't do the keys anymore, because you've got 24 keys. You've got 12 major and 12 minor, all right? And do some research on your laptops, and you'll actually be quite surprised. You'll be very surprised. But there are far more tracks in the minor key than the major key. And also, if you want to do uplift the room, if you want to get more euphoria in the room, and more excitement and more happiness, more of this uplifting feel, play tracks in the major key. Boom, can't go wrong. Major key, if you want to make the room feel uplifting and vibrant, the major key. So if you've got this dip in the room where it's feeling a little bit moody and just bored, boredom in the room. Doesn't matter what you're playing. If there's a bit of boredom going on, look at your tracks, find tracks that you like, find tracks in the major key and play them, and you will straight away see more of an uplift in the room, more euphoria. Keys are important. Steve Kingston, yes, absolutely, 100%, all right? Key selection to make sure you're playing in key is vital. The Van, Pump Up the Volume by Mars, everyone loves that record. Yeah, Pump Up the Volume from 1989, I think, something like that. Also, did you know, I think it was Pump Up the Volume, was the first track to be made with the beat and the bass, or the beat, the same key as the bass line. Prior to that, with the 808 and 808 drum machine, I think, the beat was just, it was made. It had the key of the drum machine that made it. But I think Bomb the Bass Beat This was the first track with the do-do-do-do-do-do-do. The beat itself was in key with the track. So this is why now you do have to be so careful when mixing in key, even if you mix out of one track or into the track that's leaving the mix with just a beat. You've still got to watch the key, because even if there's just a beat playing at the end of the track and a beat playing at the track that you're bringing in, if those two beats aren't in key, it will still sound a little bit off. It's about proper programming. Yes, it is, completely. DJ Kelly Kell. The programming here is about track selection. Now, also, another way of looking at it is, and this is from a general perspective, soul tracks we can class as mellow. Hip-hop tracks we can class as, you know, slightly above mellow. So if we look at a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being like chilled out and relaxed, and 10 being full-on hyper, in-your-face, vibrant, your sort of smoochy tracks, end-of-the-night tracks, Lady in Red, Chris de Burgh, George Michael, Whitney Houston sort of tracks, but the slow ones, are going to be 1 and 2. And then your soulful tracks are going to be 3 and 4. Hip-hop tracks, 4 to 5. House tracks, 5 to 6. Your party music, you know, the Macarena style with the vibe and energy, 6 to 7. And then when you go into the likes of, say, some drum and bass and, you know, GABA and techno tracks, or, you know, full-on dance tracks, you're looking sort of 8, 9, and 10. So, you know, what you don't want to do is just play 10 all the time, because you're going to wear people out. You definitely don't want to play 5, because you're just going to have a lull. And you definitely don't want to play 1. So maybe, again, another analogy for you. If you like fishing, or you like going on a boat trip, and you're not fussed about the weather, and you're going on a boat trip for, say, a weekend, wouldn't it be boring just to have a flat sea all day long and all night long? You know, because it, all right, it would be great. You know, you can relax, but it would just get slightly boring. On the other hand, if it starts off a bit choppy, then you go into calm waters, then it goes choppy again, and then it goes rough, and then it goes a bit choppy and calm again, you're taken on a natural journey. And it's the same with music. You know, on the sea, you would never go from flat calm to full on roughness. It just couldn't happen. All right. It couldn't happen unless you were falling off a cliff somewhere or whatever. You'd have to have something in between. So what you don't want to do is you don't want to go from a smoochy song into happy hardcore. Because that's just nuts. You know, you imagine you've got people smooching and dancing, you know, and then all of a sudden you play, I want to be a hippie. And it's like, where are you at? What are you doing as a DJ? You need to get them there. You know, take them on this journey because you're in charge of taking them on the journey. You're in charge of the music. You're in charge of the produce you've got in the kitchen if you're a chef, because a good chef can knock up something from nothing. A bad chef, even if the bad chef was given it the greatest ingredients in the world, could just obliterate the restaurant because they don't know what they're doing. And this is very true with DJing. You can have a DJ doesn't know what they're doing, who's got the best tracks in the world and dies a death. You've got a DJ who does know what they're doing, who's got minimal tracks, but will be able to work out a game plan for those tracks to make sure the crowd walk away loving the evening because of track selection. Very important. Okay. Virgil Williams, message retracted. Okay, probably because it was silly. DJ Kelly Carl, I believe Pump Up the Volume was released in 87. Yeah, it was quite early, sort of 87. You probably can Google it. You're probably not far wrong there. Steve Kingston, F and G all day. F and G. Okay, the keys, yeah. But again, is that F major or minor? I'm not sure, but I always go with the major keys. I try and make sure I'm playing major keys, especially the likes of New Year's Eve. You know, what I tend to do is New Year's Eve gigs, that's if I'm going to be working this New Year's Eve, is go through my tracks, get a folder, put all of the tracks that are in the major key in that folder and try and work around those. Try mostly to work around the major keys. And you can't go wrong. You can't go wrong. Okay. If you're using Recordbox to run your playlist through, if you can set your playlist on key anywhere. Yeah, you can. Right. See, Steve Kingston, major keys, yes. Because they've just got more uplift. They're more vibrant. They're more euphoric. They feel better. And what I'd like you to try and do, and this is a test for the people out there, for anyone watching now or in the future, don't look at the keys on your tracks, but I want you to just play, say, 10 tracks and just try this and get a piece of paper and put track 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then play snippets of each of the tracks, not a few seconds, but say a minute of each track. Don't look at the keys. And I want you next to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to 10, just write down a number based on the energy and how that track makes you feel. Does it make you feel happy, sad, moody? So you could do, say, happy, sad, or moody, and give it a number based on happy, sad, or moody. And if that track, some of them, or one of them, or two or three, make you feel happy, just have a look and see if they're in the major scale. And you may be surprised that maybe one or two of them quite possibly are. Now, even though they may be in the minor scale, they may make you feel happy. But there's about an internal energy that tracks in the major scale give you. There's just something about them that is far more uplifting and far better to use to enlighten a crowd, to make them feel as though they're happy, okay? And so always try and go with major. There is more uplift, that's it. Okay, Steve Kingstone, all right. So I'm gonna finish this stream now. I would, again, like to thank everyone for watching. Blaze, do you wanna come here a minute? So earlier on, I had a comment from, where is that comment gone? Blaze Lewis, it's so weird watching someone on live from the house that you're in. And here he is. Say hello. All right. So thank you for watching, ladies and gentlemen. All right. I appreciate you taking part. There will be more live streams, and let's do this again. So, hey, Ella Skins, Thanks for all the advice on your channel. What's the best place for beginners to get tracks from? I've just bought a DDJ 400. I'm starting out. The van says, hi, Blaze. Love your channel, Paul C. Okay, so Gibbo. All right, that's a tough one. Now, what I would do possibly is it might be an idea if you're starting out to go on the likes of eBay and get some of the Now series. It's called Now What I Call Music, because they're great compilations from the decades. Now, you may be able to get them downloadable, or you may want to buy them, the copies on CD. But once you've got the hard copy, you know, you can burn them and then you've got them on your laptop. So it is quite difficult now to get sort of a good selection of old school music. Now, what I have got here, right, Blink 61, I appreciate you. Thank you. Lee Fraser, miss this. I'll watch it back. Bye, guys. Lee Fraser. Okay. I have got the Essential series here. Now, this is from CD Pool. Now, the Essential series is your, I would class the sort of tunes you'd play at a wedding. So, you know, you've got Rock DJ, Robbie, you've got, all right, Robbie Williams, your All Saints, Atomic Kitten, S Club 7, Bee Gees, Buggles, Carl Douglas, ABBA, you've got Al Green, there's Fun Loving Criminals on here, Casey and the Sunshine Band, Leo Sayer, Martha and the Muffins, Neil Diamond, The Jam, Grease, Elvis Presley. You know, these are the sort of tunes that are great for a wedding. But go and check out, so they're called Now That What I Call Music. And they've been going since the 80s. So if you think about it, if you want a collection of music that's great for a commercial gig, then you're looking at music that has been played on the radio. And the Now What I Call Music series is sort of the popular music of that era when it started, which is the 80s, all the way through to now. I believe there's now 100 and something or other. I stopped buying them when it was about 100 or 99. But, you know, what you've got there is you've got the regular tracks that people will listen to. So that's a great collection to have that gives you a backbone of popular music from the past however many years. Best place to get tracks is BPM Supreme. Okay, DJ Kelly Kell, nice one for that. All right, Sean Piercy, also Amazon for CDs, compilations for parties, weddings, private events, yes. Now, the other thing I'd like to point out as well is you can't go wrong with best of. So, okay, so if I put best of and then 60s and then disco, house, a soul, and so on. So what I mean by that is, 60s, the six doesn't work. So what do I mean by best of? Okay. So what you've got is you will have tracks and compilations, and it's like the best of. So what they'll do is they'll get the best of reggae, the best of disco, the best of rock and roll, the best of hip hop. So they're great to have, you know, as a backbone, let's say, for a certain style, you know, so the best of 90s dance music. I mean, you can't go wrong with that stuff. All right. Now started here in the States around 1998. So for here in the US, we're up to now 76. Okay, yeah. The Now series, that's DJ Kelly Kell. The Now series started in the UK, I think it was, yeah, in the 80s. Sean Piercy, Eldis remixes, extended mixes. You've got loads of DJ pools. DJ City, DMP, DMS, The Mashup, BPM Supreme, just some ideas. Thank you for all this, guys. Jibbo, have looked at Beatport, but the subscription puts me off a little. bit as a beginner. Yeah, it will do. Yeah. Okay, Vids VR. Beatport doesn't have a subscription, Gibbo. At least I didn't. I don't. Okay. All right. Well, listen, guys. I'm going to call it a day now. Thank you for watching. Don't forget, like and share. And if you haven't already, subscribe to the channel. And I look forward to chatting with you again. And by the way, you know, in these videos and others, if there's a certain subject you'd like me to go over, then put it in there, put it in a comment, and let's get some content going. It's about community spirit and sharing. And don't forget, what I say, stay safe. Crazy times, guys. It's crazy times. But I'll finish off with practice and enjoy. Thank you. See you guys.